Oftentimes when you hear me talk about desktop portals or even just make an offhand mention, it's in the context of Wayland plus Pipewire to capture your desktop. But this is just one small part, and the more wider primary use is a Linux desktop permission system, and I guess in a sense, that's part of that as well. Now, this was initially developed for use with the Flatpak sandbox, but has since been expanded for use with the Snap architecture as well. But you also see them used outside of a sandbox for things like the file picker portal to make sure you're always using your native file picker or just capturing your Wayland desktop. It doesn't have to be done from the OBS Flatpak. Now, with the release of 1.19.1 of the desktop portals, there was a massive improvement to what can even be permission controlled in the first place, along with a massive improvement to a long-running existing portal. And I think we'll start with the latter. So one of the portals that's been around for a very long time is the notification portal. This basically allows a sandboxed application to interact with your system's notification daemon, allowing that application to generate notifications if that's something it wants to do. Now, you might not like notifications, some people do, and you want that to be a thing that is possible if an application wants it. This was first merged in July of 2016. Need notification portal. It was so early on that they weren't even really using like a sensible naming structure yet. Like, this is way before anybody even really cared about the solution. Now, for the Linux desktop, especially the Linux desktop back in 2016, this did basically everything it needs to do. Emphasis on basically. Over the years, there have been some improvements, some enhancements made, but because this is not the only part of the project, you can't make a giant sweeping change. Keep in mind, each of the desktops have their own implementation of the portal backend as well to make sure it integrates with their desktop. So if you want to make some giant change, you need a V2 version of the specification. Now, this is something that eventually came about. This was first introduced as an idea back in March of 2023 by a GNOME developer known as Jonas. Whilst this is good enough for the Linux desktop, it's not good enough for mobile. And remember, GNOME has a mobile version as well. I know not that many people use it, and most people don't really care about Linux mobile, but it is a thing that exists that they do want to make, you know, better and more viable. So this is about improving it for more advanced notification needs like those on a smartphone. So, things that we want. Firstly, playing sound or vibrating on notifications. Fair enough. This isn't something you'd want to do on the Linux desktop, and I don't believe there's any notification daemons. Maybe sound? But, you know, your keyboard doesn't vibrate. Maybe you could vibrate like a PS5 controller, but I really doubt there's any notification daemons that support that. If there is, tell me about it. Persistent notifications remain at the top of the tray and can't be dismissed. Now, most desktops have an implementation for this that certain applications can interact with. You might see this for things like Caden Live with a render. You might see this with a download, things like that. But it wasn't something that was supported within the portal. And this is something that probably should be there and actually would be useful on the desktop as well. Standardized hints about the content of the notification, inspired by the ideas in desktop notification specification. That's obviously a mistake. Standardized actions that are useful for a range of similar apps, e.g. for inline replies to chat messages. This example isn't something you would necessarily use on the desktop, but you know, standardized download bars and things like that definitely would be useful. Grouping similar notifications, e.g. for multiple chat messages from one contact. A lot of notification daemons kind of fake this already, but having that be codified in the way the portal works would be a good idea. And presenting rich content in notifications, e.g. progress bars or images. Most notification daemons do support both of these already. But again, it should be there in the portal. And there are things that shouldn't be done. Notifications are always presented immediately to the user. We don't want the API to defer the presentation to a later point. So you can't start queuing up notifications and then just dump them later on, which I guess makes sense. You could always just spam at any point anyway. So I don't really know why that would be something you'd even consider. We don't want an API for showing N unseen notification badges on app icons. I don't know. I'm kind of torn on this. I like the idea of that being an option for an application that wants to show, say, this is how many messages you haven't seen, things like that, or this is how many emails that have been sent to you, things like that, but I don't know. I get it. I think it's useful, and it is what it is. We don't want persistent notifications to be abused as app indicators. That's why they are removed when the app closes. This is the reason why GNOME is not a fan of the system tray, because they don't like the idea of persistent applications being used there. There are probably ways you could still abuse this anyway if you have a download bar, things like that. There are always going to be ways that you can get around this, but I guess it's a good goal to have. We don't want to expose notification urgency as it is right now to avoid abuse by apps. So you can't say, you must see this notification right now and have some way to alert the user that this is super important. Again, for the same reason, there are applications out there that do like to abuse things like this to always be right at the top. Now, both being a very well laid out specification, basically answering all of the stuff you'd want answered off the start, not trying to design the entire specification in the comments, which I've seen happen before and ends up being a giant mess, along with it being proposed from somebody in the GNOME world, most people here were quite receptive to the idea, and obviously there were issues that need to be ironed out and need to be in a better state to merge, but it eventually did get merged in a relatively quick way, by November 15th, 2024, so only about a year in development. Now, this is cool and is nice to see, but isn't really going to change that much for you on the desktop. Even if it's an option there, most apps aren't going to use it. It's more of a thing in the mobile world. Now, the other portal I want to talk about, this has been much longer a work in progress, and actually is going to affect you. The introduction of the USB portal. This has been a work in progress, probably an idea for longer than has actually been an issue on the repo. The earliest issue that I can find is 227 from 2018, add USB device access portal. But there are other portals that are like tangentially related that are specific kinds of USB devices. This is the one that is the generic USB, and this is the one that is actually referenced in the chain of issues and chain of pull requests to get to the point where this is actually introduced. Now, this is a portal that should have existed a very long time ago and probably should have existed from the very start. The basic idea is if we actually care about sandboxing, this is the biggest hole in the sandbox. This defeats the entire point. Because before this portal existed, you would need to give the Flatpak access to every single USB device on your system. Now, obviously, you're going to want most applications to have access to your keyboard and access to your mouse. But if it's a text editor, for example, does it need access to your game controllers or your audio interface or your video devices or your phone that happens to be plugged in or your USB thumb drive? In that case, maybe it does. But a lot of other applications, like a calculator, for example, might not need access to basically any of those. Depending on the context, different applications are going to want access to different devices, and you're going to want to give applications access to those devices. And this is exactly the kind of problem that is perfect for permission controlling. A conditional, do you want access to this hardware? Now, whilst permission controlling USB devices with portals might be new, the idea of USB permission controls is not new for platforms that actually care about permission controlling. Every single one of them have a way to do this. But initially, there was kind of pushback against doing this within the portals, but not for the reason you might think. The way forward for these is some application that needs the device to step up and get a design for a portal, propose a portal API, and implement it. I am happy to assist with these steps, but I'm unlikely to produce more portals all by myself without concrete involvement from API consumers. So back in 2018, like with back in 2016, not as bad as then, but still pretty bad, there just wasn't that much adoption of this technology. So you can sit here designing portals all day, but if no applications are adopting those portals, you're basically wasting your time. So what he wanted is commitment from the applications that would want to use these portals, that the portal that is being made is something they would use and is something that is actually useful. Now, if you're used to the Whalen videos, you probably know what I'm going to say next. Whilst this was started in 2018, and there was certainly some interest after that initial pushback, it took quite a while for there to actually be an implementation. That didn't happen until 2021 by Refi64. This is the implementation on the Flatpak side, and this is the implementation on the portal side. They were done within a couple of days of each other. Even without going any further, you can probably tell exactly what happened here. This is a draft. This is set to closed. Neither of these ended up being the final implementation that was worked on. For the same reason, again, that you'd probably expect. Work was going strong for a good couple of months between, in this case, two people. The person who made the original issue and the person who made the pull request. And then people get busy, they have lives, they have to do other things, and look, I wouldn't want to reply to giant message threads like this every single day either. I totally get it. Someone said, is there any progress on this after nothing had been done for a while? And yeah, again, radio silence, they had things to do. Then we get to this comment right here. Where is it? From Cerebit. I'm waiting on this for one of my projects. If I can help out in any way, let me know. This was July 26th of 2021, and the next comment wasn't until September. There just wasn't really that much drive to get this done at the time. Then, a little bit later, in October of 2021, there was some drive-by corrections by Georgia Stavrakis. Nothing major, just some, like, little corrections to bring some attention to this and try to hopefully, you know, somewhat move it forward. I didn't really go that much further forward because the next comment wasn't until April of 2022. Again, this was from October 2021. Then, a whole 2 years later, Georgia Stavrakis took over the portal himself. Not disregarding the work there was good, but taking that work and then bringing it up to the standard of the portals now, fixing it up, actually finishing off the development. At least that was the plan. USB Portal 1238 by Georgia Stavrakis. The USB Portal is the middleman between sandbox applications and the devices connected and available to the host system. This is the first version of the portal marked as closed. This was opened on December 9th, 2023. Let's scroll down just a bit and see where the comments stop. December 20th, 2023. Next comment, February of this year. And then, October of this year. You know what? I think 11 days of work is actually, like, a new record. I have not seen this many comments and this much work done over 11 days and then nothing done for almost an entire year. If you can find me another issue that's like that, I would love to see it, but I don't think it's a thing. With that being said though, someone else did take over the work a couple of weeks ago, that being Hubert Figure. USB Portal continued, and this one has been merged. And the work did get merged by Georgia Stavrakis, and again, this wasn't done completely blind. This took that work, rebased it to a new version, got it all ready, and then went from there. Also, if we go over to the related Flatpak issue, the merge request over here was made by Georgia Stavrakis. Now you might be wondering, why did the work start back up again, and how did it actually get finished this time? Well, the answer is pretty simple. money, and the Sovereign Tech Fund. The development version of Flatpak has received support for listing enumerable and blocked USB devices. This is the first step towards a fully featured USB portal, which is in the works and has now been merged and introduced in a released version. Released a pre-release version. Flatpak itself doesn't expose nor block USB devices, but it provides the metadata for the USB portal to allow or deny an app's access to particular devices. With this mechanism, apps can request access to devices without opening holes in the sandbox. In this case, the sandbox hole is quite big. Apps that access USB devices need to give access to all devices on the system. In addition to that, App Store reviewers can review ahead of time which USB permissions the apps will be requesting, which may add an extra layer of security and trust to Flatpak-based app stores like FlatHub. I would agree to this if it doesn't lead to every single application being marked as unsafe, because yeah, that is a problem that FlatHub does have with overly using that term. This work was only made possible thanks to the Sovereign Tech Fund, various community members that helped reviewing and shaping up the feature, and Hub for pushing it to the finish line. I assume that is referring to Hubert over here, who I've never heard anyone shorten the name Hubert to Hub, but hey, if that's what you want to do, that's cool. I know there's been talk of having a portal like this for a very long time now, and it's something that basically needed to be there to make the idea actually make sense. It'll take a while for applications to actually start using the portal. It'll take a bit for desktops to have the implementations actually ready so applications can use it and know the portal's going to be there. Many of them may just never do it and request access to all USB devices on your system, and that's just the way it is. But it is a good step in the right direction to make this actually possible. But what do you think of sandboxing? What do you think of permission systems? I'd love to know. So, if you like the video, go like the video. And if you really like the video and you want to become one of these amazing people over here, check out the Patreon, Scribes, Liberape, linked in the description down below. That's going to be it for me, and go hang out with the Hub.